Good morning, friends. First of all, let me thank Mr. Kocher for inviting me here. I have been one person who has been almost participating in all the events which he organizes. And I was just telling him this since long time now. So again, he has given me this opportunity and I must thank him. My dear friend Aruna, Radha Chauhan, Dadu, all of us have been working in this system for a long time. And of course, Mr. Paro Singh, Abhijit, all other friends I see in the audience. The thought or the topic which was sent to me in the email is mobility and the new economy. So I'm certainly not an economist and therefore I'll not be able to pontificate on those issues. But certainly I'll talk about mobility and especially about digital part of it, because digital, computers, ICT, these have been my areas of work since last about 30-35 years, and I feel very comfortable talking about them. So let me begin with the Digital India. Sameer spoke about it. And I think Digital India is one of the most comprehensive program which has been put forward and announced and blessed by our Prime Minister. And that program seeks to transform India into a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy. So that's the broad vision of this program. And this program has now, you know, three layers in some sense, which call three vision areas. The first layer is digital infrastructure as a utility to citizens. So obviously no software can, you know, work unless there is an underlying hardware. And no software in the current sort of days or current time work unless it is having ubiquitous connectivity is there underlying that software. So therefore the first vision area or the first layer of digital India was digital infrastructure as a utility to citizens. The second area was, the vision area is essentially the software and services which are going to ride on this digital infrastructure. So what we said was software and services on demand. So that's the second layer. And obviously the second layer will not be able to work unless you have the first layer, which is the digital infrastructure. And the last layer or the topmost layer is digital empowerment of citizens. And obviously software and services are not going to work unless citizen is empowered to really take advantage of them. So these three were very logically, you know, put one over another. And then this whole program was articulated and conceptualized. And I think whatever I have seen, people may have had their thoughts about Digital India, speed being very slow, not being implemented, or there are other issues. Nobody has actually challenged the comprehensiveness of this program or the logical connected aspect of all these three vision areas. And of course, these were further translated into what is called 9 pillars. And the whole idea of translating them into 9 pillars was that then we will have quantifiable targets which we can put together, which need to be achieved to realize the vision of Digital India. So therefore, we had those 9 pillars, and these pillars were information on demand, public information access points, digital identity infrastructure, and many other, cashless India. So these were actually the vision, the actual pillars of this. So we are talking of cashless. It's a part of, integral part of Digital India program, which is identity on the cloud, the entitlements on the cloud, people, private space on public cloud. These are some of the things which were articulated. And the whole vision, again, as I said, was to transform India into a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy. So let me talk about a couple of these areas, and I'll talk about the areas which are creating a little bit of, you know, which are falling behind in some sense. So the sort of bottommost area is the digital infrastructure. And digital infrastructure, in my view, has got two parts. You can subdivide or slice it into two parts. One is the hardware infrastructure, and another is that software infrastructure. For example, identity is a soft infrastructure, which is a part of infrastructure. Nevertheless, it is not a hard infrastructure. Connectivity is a hard infrastructure. Now, unfortunately, the connectivity in this country has not grown the way it should have grown. And that is coming in the way of a very, you know, swift rollout of the Digital India program. I'll give you one example. Recently, we participated in an Asia-Pacific event, and they have ranked the countries in terms of fixed ICT infrastructure. And India actually is at the rate at 7%. Singapore is 98%. Malaysia is 65%. Vietnam is 36%. Thailand is 35%. Sri Lanka is 14%. We are at 7%. We are one of the lowest in the connectivity index, ICT index. So there is a lot of work which needs to be done to provide broadband connectivity. You know, broadband is currently defined in a very poor sort of 512 kbps and stuff like that. Nowhere you call this 512 kbps as a broadband. Minimum speed of broadband is 2 megabits per second. So if you take that speed as a minimum speed, the number of people who have access to internet really comes down very substantially in our country. So I think what is required is to improve the connectivity infrastructure. And why are we at a position where we are today? It has a little bit of history in it. See, when we started on this mobile revolution in late 90s and early 2000s, we had virtually no fixed lines. Fixed telephone lines, the total number was only 20 million in the whole country. And that also, if you divide it house-wise and, you know, office-wise, probably a large portion will be in the offices. So we have a complete lack of fixed line infrastructure. And then we, you know, had the mobile, and now we have 1 billion plus mobile connections in this country. And we are, you know, there's a talk time of 11 billion minutes per day. That's the scale. So we have really done a wonderful work in terms of connecting India from a voice perspective. But what has also happened is, because there was no growth in the fixed lines and mobiles continue to grow, the data connectivity, which is so important now, is being provided by generally wireless, by mobile, you know, 2G, 3G and now 4G. Now, mobile wireless data can never be A, reliable, because it's all wireless and you may come somewhere to an area where you don't have the connectivity. It is not very robust, and it is also not very large in terms, you know, the bandwidth is a constraint typically. So you can't have as fast a bandwidth as you can have through a piped infrastructure. So now we are feeling the crunch where data demand is going up, but the supply is not there, and supply is only the wireless, mobile wireless supply. So we have serious issues. For example, in the villages, when you want to do UPI transaction, even if I have a smartphone, if there is no 3G or 4G connectivity, I cannot do any transaction. So these are some of the real constraints. And what we need to do also in our, you know, job at TRAI, we have made a number of recommendations. And I think these recommendations, if followed, could really transform transform our ranking, which is abysmally low. We are 155th out of 180 countries in the whole world. We are worse than Nigeria or whatever, you know, you can think of any country in Africa. That's where we are. So while we are a great software power in terms of connectivity infrastructure, we are very poor. So what can happen? One recommendation which we have given is that there are 100 million digital cable TVs in this country. India has digitized, you know, up to phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 is complete. Phase 4 is going to be completed in December 31, 2016, which means that all these the cable TV connection will become digital. Already about 90% or 80% plus are digital. So if you have 100 million homes where you take this digital cable TV, this 100 million homes can actually have access to the broadband, because the same pipe with a little bit of upgradation can be used for delivery of robust broadband connectivity. That recommendation has been sent by TRAI a number of times. We have been following it up with the Department of Telecom and Ministry of Information and Broadcasting. And we are saying, look, this is something, you don't have to grapple with the issues like right of way, because that local cable operator has already solved that problem, last mile problem. He has taken out somebody's roof, some tree, somewhere. He has reached there. Use that pipe. Yesterday that pipe was only able to transmit the cable TV signals. Today that pipe also can transfer, you know, bits and bytes. Use that. So that can actually immediately provide connectivity, robust connectivity to 50 million people, because if you take an average family size of 500 million people, 100 million homes means 500 million people. So imagine how much, you know, immediately the availability will really improve and increase. And ultimately, let us realize, a robust bandwidth usage is not done while moving. Because in moving, you might do emails, moving, you might look at the news. When you are sitting home, then and only then you will, you know, do some real stuff which requires reliable data connection and a speedy data connection. So I think that's one. Secondly, the BharatNet project, which is being implemented by Government of India. Aruna is here and she knows this, sort of my views on that. My views are, you might create great infrastructure, but for marketing the infrastructure, for maintaining the infrastructure, for having the SLAs, etc., you require public-private partnership. Without that, this infrastructure, even if you create, will not be utilized to the optimal extent. So PPP model for BharatNet, we have given recommendations to the government. That also, if it is done, it will actually improve the utilizability. And wherever it has not been constructed, this construction itself can also be given to PPP basis. So that's the second part. Third is, in the telecom policy 2012, we have what is called open sky policies declared there, whereby we are saying that satellite, you know, bandwidth shall be available in a very free market manner. Unfortunately, it is still remains clogged with the Department of Space, you know, some antariksh corporation. They canalize this entire bandwidth provision, and the result is that we have very costly bandwidth, and this is needed in areas where we can't lay fiber, you know, in an accessible area, northeast, Jammu and Kashmir. There we need this, but unfortunately it's very costly, unsustainable. And today we have hybrid satellites which are throughput is very large, and these could be utilized. So a policy tweak, policy change to make this satellite bandwidth available in a free market manner, open skies, should be another way to improve the supply of the bandwidth to broadband to our country. Lastly, we have had a consultation on the Wi-Fi hotspots in the country, and what our vision is that we should create a national grid of Wi-Fi hotspots, so that I just authenticate myself once, I attach my payment instrument only once, and then wherever I'm traveling throughout the country, I should be able to access the Wi-Fi, you know, network anywhere, because, you know, and then, you know, everybody could become a seller, so to say. If there is a grocery shop owner, he can supply Wi-Fi to his own customers who can do digital transactions there, UPI transactions, because that then, even if he doesn't have the 2G or 3G connectivity, he can certainly have that data. So I think a couple of steps which need to be taken, and I think we should take every step possible to ensure that we have better broadband connectivity in this country. So that's something which needs to be done. On the other issue of soft infrastructure, which is, Samir mentioned about this, Aadhaar, we now have actually 107 crores or 108 crore people in this country have got Aadhaar numbers. And those numbers are now being leveraged very, very much. you know, we are doing DBT transactions of the order of 140 million transactions per month. In LPG alone, we are transferring subsidy. We are transferring 2 billion subsidy credit transactions every year. So that's a very, very large number. So we are leveraging that. We are using it for distribution of, you know, food grains in public distribution system in a number of states. We have used Aadhaar number to clean the databases, and there is a huge efficiency in LPG alone. There is a saving of 20,000 crores. So the digital ID infrastructure is being used, and more importantly, you know, just give you an example. The electronic KYC, a product which Aadhaar has brought out, which effectively says that you do your biometric authentication and the digitally signed copy of your Aadhaar will be given to the domain who is getting it done. Now that actually has, recently it has been introduced in getting telecom connections. And one of the operators, Reliance Jio, in the last 120 or whatever days, they have done 52 million or 55 million connections. And they have done it through electronic KYC. Completely paperless, with a low cost, and it has been estimated that telecom eKYC alone will actually be able to save 10,000 crores per annum. Because the cost of acquisition of one customer doing his paper KYC, maintaining those papers, and then many times paying fines to the term cell of the DOT for not maintaining these papers, etc., appropriately, that's a huge cost. And these papers, by the way, are maintained, the CAF form and the KYC papers are maintained in air-conditioned rooms. So those, everything will go away. So the electronic KYC, and recently I heard that we are going to use it for various exams, so that A does not sit in place of B in an exam and clears it, and finally, you know, B gets the naukri. That should not happen. So in the CBSE board and other things, you are using electronic KYC or Aadhaar authentication. It is being used for opening bank account. Janadhan bank accounts were opened using electronic KYC in a large number. So we have built a number of products. Electronic KYC is one such product. I was talking to Aruna about e-sign. Now India is the only country in the world where you have digital signatures on demand, which means you don't need a dongle or you don't need a long process of verification of your identity. You can just do it online, real time, and finally get your document signed, and that's it. Digital locker actually is built on that concept where you can digitally sign the documents kept there and share them seamlessly with anybody else. So I think, and Aruna is doing now leading that whole effort of, you know, e-sign, digital locker, and many other initiatives which are a part of Digital India mission. So I think lots and lots of things are happening in the software side. Now you have the ORS, which is online reservation system in the hospitals. You know, people used to come from Bihar, Jharkhand, and be here, be in the line every day at 4 p.m. And, you know, then the quota used to get exhausted and they go back to Dharamsala where they are staying. Now they can actually do a reservation sitting at their homes. So lots and lots of developments have taken place. And here India is taking the lead. We are not, you know, emulating somebody's technologies. We are not. We are actually building our own technology stack. And that technology stack actually is now being sort of looked into by institutions like World Bank. Many other institutions are looking at it, how India has done it at such a scale, in such a cost-effective manner. The total cost of Aadhaar is less than 10,000 crores. And it has saved 20,000 crores per annum in LPG alone. So imagine the extent of savings which it can bring about. And it is bringing about. It's already going to save 10,000 crores in eKYC in telecom. So I think there are a whole lot of technologies which have been built. India is ready for it. Talking of, you know, financial inclusion. Now, UIDAI published a paper in April of 2010 where we talked about micro ATM and Aadhaar-enabled payment systems. The title of that thing was From Exclusion to Inclusion Through Micropayments. That book is available still on the UIDAI site. So this vision of, you know, having completely digital transactions and a cashless India, has been there. And now India has really one of the finest technology stack to make this happen. The UPI architecture is one of the finest architecture for any mobile payment system. It is as robust as doing banking on NEFT, RTGS or IMPS. It is absolutely cost effective. The digital transaction or transferring money becomes as easy as making a phone call. And it is completely unbundled. It is completely interoperable. You can have any application provider. You can have any bank in your of your bank, your bank where your bank account is. The other person to whom you are transferring money can have some other bank. He can have some other application service provider software. And everything talks to each other through well-defined APIs. So you have UPI. We have those who do not have feature smartphones. We have got USSD. And USSD transactions, as you know, TRAI had reduced that charge to 50 paisa in place of 1 rupee 50 paisa per transaction. We have also increased the number of steps from 5 to 8. So it has really become very cheap now. Now, what is required is actually to integrate it to the mainstream, to mainstream the USSD transactions, because currently the transactions you have to enter IFSC code and, you know, bank account number and stuff like that, which never succeeds. So therefore, and I'm told NPCI has created a task force which is working, and their deadline is by the, you know, in the next few days, they will come up with a solution which is actually very friendly as UPI. So then poor people through their USSD transactions will be able to do as good a banking as any other person does with the smartphone. Then finally, if you don't have any card, if you don't have any, just have a bank account, you can do AEPS, Aadhaar Enabled Payment Systems. So go to any BC and you can do, and Aruna is rolling that out through the common service centers. So I think today we have in place a system where if you have a card, you can do the payments, banking. If you don't have a card, if you just have the smartphone, you can take UPI. If you don't have a smartphone, if you have just Aadhaar number, you can do AEPS. And of course, wallets are already there. Unfortunately, wallets are not interoperable as yet. So I think something will have to be done to make them also interoperable, because we do not want digital silos. Digital silos are absolutely unrequired. In this place, you need to have, for a big country like India, where every market player should have a play, interoperability is the immediate requirement. And fortunately, the systems which we have built are all interoperable. So I think in this also, and today, we are at a tipping point. You know, everybody has a phone, either a smart or a feature. And if you enable everybody, then you see this whole jam trinity, which was talked about in the last year's budget, Janadhan, Aadhaar and mobile, if you link them all, this becomes an extremely powerful trinity. Janadhan, Aadhaar and mobile, if you link them all, this becomes an extremely powerful trinity where you are able to do through your Janadhan account, you are financially included. Your Aadhaar, you can do any transactions proving your identity. And your mobile becomes the vehicle of communication and actually an instrument which can be used for doing all these transactions. So this jam trinity, softwares, architectures, systems, they are all in place. And what we need is essentially create more awareness, create more, you know, sort of systems. What also is needed is actually having a relook on the entire mechanism of charging. See, currently you have what is called merchant discount rate. Now the merchant discount rate, let's say 2%, which means the merchant has to pay 2% to whosoever has given him that POS device. Which means if I purchase a goods of 100 rupees, the merchant will get 98 and 2 rupees he will have to pay. So obviously, this person will be more interested in taking cash from you, because then he doesn't have to pay anybody. Now this, unless, you know, the digital transactions will not become sustainable unless we actually have a complete relook on this cost structure, the MDR and the charges which they do. And my view is these costs must be fixed on the principle of work done, like we do in telecom sector. In telecom sector, you say interconnect users charges 14 paisa It is 14 paisa because that is what has been computed to be the work done by the other telecom operator. Similarly, if UPI is doing a transaction and the bank, the two banks and the NPCI is not doing anything except creating a record, additional record of, you know, debit and credit, there's no really no work done. So therefore, effectively, the charge should be zero. So my view is that it is important because people will do digital in a sustainable manner, provided A, they have the convenience, it is convenient, and it certainly will become convenient, you know, because you don't have to have the cash. It also look into the cost, because it should not cost much, and people should have confidence. So convenient, cost, and confidence in the system, whether, you know, the digital transaction goes through, it happens. Otherwise, you know, if it doesn't happen or there's some error, then the confidence is shaken. So these three things are important, and I think we have to look into these three issues for a long term to ensure that we remain digital and the India remains cashless, because it should not happen that now we are going cashless and suddenly because of these transaction charges, we revert back. That should not happen. So we need to ensure that the movement, which has started in a very big way, is actually sustained and continued. So these are some of the thoughts which I had to share with you, friends. Thank you very much for inviting me.